And the last topic I would like to mention in the context of multi-objective optimization is how to use heuristics that you have seen in the previous lecture in this context. And as you will see, it's quite straightforward and quite powerful as well. In the context of heuristics, we had three concepts. The concept of neighborhood for exploration of the space, the concept of local search for intensification, and the concept of meta-heuristics for diversification. In the context of multi-objective optimization, these three things will be the same, except for the local search. So we will have to design neighborhoods as before, and we will have these meta-heuristics like simulated annealing or variable neighborhood search or whatever that will do diversification. But the main difference is instead of having the candidate to be the best solution, the candidate to be the optimal solution that will be the output of the algorithm, in this case, we will maintain a set. And this set contains the potential members of the Pareto optimal set. So this set that I denote on this slide, capital P, contains values such that they are not mutually dominating each other. So for each pair XY in the set, X is not dominating Y, and Y is not dominating X. So how does it work for the local search? So we start with the first set of candidate solutions. Well, typically we can put one feasible solution. Then at each iteration of the local search, we first select randomly a candidate, and we will build the neighborhood of this candidate, exactly like we do in regular heuristics. We consider a neighbor X plus of X, and we define two sets. D of X plus is the set of all solutions which are in my set P that are dominated by X plus. In other words, DX plus is the set of points which are worse in the sense of dominance than X plus. The second set, S, X plus, is the set of Ys in my set P, so the candidates that I am currently considering, that are better, again in the sense of dominance, than X plus. Now, if S of X plus is not empty, it means that X plus is dominated by some candidates that I have already, and therefore I just reject X plus. I don't consider it anymore. Now, if this set is empty, so it means that there is no point in the candidate set that is dominating X plus, so I add X plus to the set, it's a new candidate, and then I remove all the points in the set that are dominated by X plus to maintain the property that all pair of points are actually non-dominating each other. And actually, I can prove this property. So this property is verified for capital P, and we need to prove that it is again verified for capital P plus. For all X and Y that are different from X plus, well, it's already the case because the property was valid in P. So of course, it's again valid in P plus. So now consider X plus and another point in P plus, Y. Because Y belongs to P plus, it means that it does not belong to D of X plus, because D of X plus has been removed. All the members of D of X plus have been removed. Therefore, it means that X plus does not dominate Y by the definition of D of X plus. And now if you consider X plus, which is in P plus, because it has been inserted in P plus, we know that S of X plus is equal to the empty set, because this is in the context when we apply the iteration. Therefore, by definition of S of X plus, Y does not belong to this set, it's empty. Therefore, Y does not dominate X plus. And we have shown that the property of capital P applies to P plus as well. Let's take an example. I have here a knapsack problem, Remember, the knapsack problem consists in maximizing the utility of the sack by making sure that the total weight does not exceed some capacity. And here I have introduced a second objective. I associate a cost with each item. When I include an item in the sack, it increases the utility, but it also increases the cost. And I would like to maximize the utility and to minimize the cost. Again, with the constraint that the total weight must not exceed the capacity. This is a multi-objective version of the knapsack problem. And for this example, I just generated random values for the cost for the sake of the example. I apply exactly the same techniques as we saw for single objective optimization. So I use a neighborhood. Here I took a neighborhood of size k for the knapsack problem, and I apply the local search as I have described in the previous slide. In this plot, I report each solution that has been generated by the algorithm. Each of these solutions is associated with a dot in this chart. The x coordinate of the dot refers to the utility, which is associated with this solution, and the y coordinate is associated with the cost. And remember, we want to maximize the utility and minimize the cost. The points which are in large blue circles are the points which are included in this capital P set that I was talking about. So these are the Pareto optimal solution that I have considered. Not that I have no clue if they are Pareto optimal for the problem, but they are Pareto optimal for all the solutions that the algorithm has generated, which are represented on this set. So they may exist other solutions which are better in the sense of dominance. I don't know, this is a heuristic. But what I can guarantee is that among all the solutions that have been generated, these ones are not dominated by anybody else. And those that I represent with a cross have been included at some point in this set P by the algorithm, but they have been removed afterwards because better solutions have been found. So it gives you a little bit the sense of how this algorithm is working. It generates candidates using the mechanisms that we have seen for single objective optimization, typically the neighborhoods. But then it decides which one to keep or to remove from the set capital P. And of course, you can also apply the meta heuristic. So here I have applied exactly the same idea by using the variable neighborhood search meta heuristic that you have seen in the lecture on optimization. And if you remember, the variable neighborhood search is trying neighborhoods of different size. So in this case, the neighborhood of size 1 allowed to find one solution to include in the Pareto solution. Now, after running the neighborhood of size 2, the number of Pareto solutions increased to 16. And then we had to wait until the neighborhood of size 7 to obtain two more solutions in the Pareto set. And then at the neighborhood of size 8, we had one additional solution, and then it didn't increase until the last neighborhood, which was of size 12. So at the end of the algorithm, we had 19 Pareto solutions. And I have generated a similar chart as we described before with the same convention. So the utility is on the x-axis, must be maximized. The cost is on the y-axis, must be minimized. And you see here, you have a sense of what this Pareto frontier looks like. And now it becomes interesting for the application, because any of these solutions could be implemented, but the decision maker has to come up with one of them. You can see that you can increase the utility all the way to something like 280 with a cost which is not increasing too much. But afterwards, if you want to go from 280 to 300, then the cost will increase a lot. From the point of view of the decision maker, it would make sense to select values which are in this area of the curve because we have a high utility. and the cost is not as bad. The interesting thing with this is that this decision is made at the end once the algorithm has generated the Pareto frontiers. And this is a big difference with the idea of combining the multiple objectives into one using weights, because in this case you have to select beforehand the value of the weights, and then the algorithm will give you one solution. Here, thanks to these heuristics, you will obtain a good approximation of the Pareto frontier, and then you can decide where on this frontier you want to be. The other advantage of this is that, as you could see, transforming a heuristic for single objective optimization into a heuristic for multiple objective optimization is really straightforward. Okay, in conclusion, I would like to say two things. First, that in the context of multi-objective optimization, it's important to define the problem correctly. And in all practical applications that I know, it's always a matter of trade-off. So you have some objective function that will increase when some others will decrease. And the central concept that we have introduced to define what is optimality in this context is the concept of Pareto optimality and Pareto frontier. And in terms of algorithm, as a follow-up from the previous lecture, I suggest to use heuristics. Why? Because on the one hand, it's extremely easy to generalize a heuristic for multi-objective optimization. We have seen how it works. And the heuristics are driven by problem knowledge, as you have seen in the last lecture. And then the good thing with this is that the outcome of a heuristic would be a set of solutions. And then as a decision maker, you are still free to choose which one you want to implement in practice.